Welcome, everyone. It's a big pleasure that so many people is attending this remote seminar. There are next people approaching the screen. So today we have a special guest, Adrien Kurkdjian. I met Adrien during my postdoc in Economa Supérieure. He was doing a PhD study there. And then he finished PhD and started to work in Antwerpen. I don't know what's the pronunciation in Belgium.
Must be good.
Okay. He's working on ultra cold gases from theoretical side. And Adrien was considering to stay in our institute for some longer time. We had such discussions 2 years ago, if I'm correct. Finally, he received a project in Antwerpen, and he decided to stay for some time in Belgium. And today he will present us his results. So Adrien, the screen is yours. Excitation spectrum of a fermionic condensate.
Okay, thank you, Krzysztof, for this introduction. Hello, everyone. Also, I wish I could have been in Warsaw, as I was saying earlier, and as it was planned initially, but still very glad to speak virtually in front of you. I will speak today then about fermionic condensate and more particularly on their dynamic properties. So their excitation spectrum, their quasi-particle, also on their dissipative dynamics. So it's quite a fundamental system, but I hope I will manage to convince you that there remain some important open questions theoretically. And what is quite exciting for the field nowadays is that those questions can be addressed by experiments. So we are able to get really a comparison to measurements. So I imagine this seminar as a very informal thing. So don't hesitate to interrupt me, ask questions. I don't know how it works exactly with Zoom to ask a question, but do so. I've prepared a rather long talk, but I can drop some parts if needed, if you want to discuss something in more detail. Voilà, so fermionic condensate, in fact, it's a system that is found in many domains of theoretical physics. You know that, for example, superconductors are a condensate of electrons, also a superfluid helium-3 can be seen as a fermionic condensate. Sometimes some phases of neutronic or nuclear matter also. But what I will focus on today are fermionic condensate that are obtained using cold gases, ultra cold gases. So these are neutral fermionic atoms that are cooled down using laser techniques. So they are in two internal states, say blue or red, or spin up or spin down. And they are cooled down by lasers until they reach quantum degeneracy, which means that each atom becomes, in fact, a very delocalized wave packet. It's the de Broglie thermal wavelength becomes, in fact, much larger than the larger than the interparticular distance. So those atoms interact, so that it's not just a free Fermi gas. They interact through van der Waals interaction. And in fact, the gas is so dilute that this interaction occurs only, the scattering due to this interaction occurs only 2 by 2. So it can be described only by a two-body scattering problem. And the interaction can be described simply by a contact potential, which mathematically is justified because the range R0 of this van der Waals interaction is in fact much, much below any other length scale which is relevant to the system. So in this regime of interaction in the cold and dilute regime, in fact, the interaction potential can be described by a single parameter called the S-wave scattering length, A. For fermions, those S-wave interactions, they occur only between opposite spin fermions, so between the red and blue here, because the probability of having the same spin fermions at the same location is suppressed by Pauli exclusion principle. So those interactions, they will favor the formation of pairs of fermions, of opposite spin fermions, spin up, spin down. And below some critical temperature, those pairs, they will appear a macroscopic coherence between them, so what is called a condensate of pairs. So it's like the analog of a Bose-Einstein condensate, but with pairs of fermions. So it's like I was saying, why was it interesting to study this system with ultra cold gases rather than in some other field of physics? It's because you have a very an important flexibility currently in the way that you can prepare, probe, excite the system. In particular, the scattering length, which measures if you want the strength of the interaction, it can be tuned in ultra cold gases using a magnetic flashback resonance, such that you can continuously prepare the system at weak or strong interaction. You can also, using ultra cold gases, play with the trapping geometry and excite the gas using laser fields, so you have a good flexibility, which means also for a theorist that the question that you may ask yourself may in the near future receive some experimental verification, and I will show you some examples today. So what the ground state and the equilibrium property in general of this system is now rather well known. There have been some analytical predictions, some measurements also experimentally, even some Monte Carlo simulations. So this is not something I will focus on today. I'll rather speak of what happens when you excite the system. So when it's weakly and maybe a bit less weakly out of equilibrium. So what kind of excitation can we expect in this system? Well, obviously, since it's a gas of pair, what you can do is break those pairs. So this is just a little diagram here. This discussion will serve as a small outline of my presentation. So those pair breaking excitation, they give rise to a fermionic branch of excitation, which to first approximation can be described just by a mean field theory. And then there are collective mode. We say collective mode because they involve this time not just one pair, but a collective motion, a coherent collective motion of all the pairs. And the first kind of collective mode that you can find, as in any superfluid, are collective excitation of the density. You can see an experimental picture here of density plane waves. So at long wavelengths, those density excitations, they are just sound waves that describe phonons. So I will discuss today the universal properties that those sound waves in Fermi condensate share with other superfluids, but also some specificity due to the fermionic nature of the gas. And then, so a question that has been quite debated lately is about collective mode. If there can exist another branch of collective mode, now at higher energy, so larger than the binding energy 2 delta of the fermion pairs. It's a debated subject. Most people now, they would call such a branch a Higgs branch for reasons that we kind of disapprove. So we use a slightly different terminology. So I'll try to clarify this debate for you today, such that if someone asks you if there is or not a Higgs branch in a fermionic condensate, then hopefully you will know what to answer. And then at the end of my talk, if I have the time, I'll try to close the loop and then come back on the fermionic spectrum, on the fermionic quasi-particle, explain to you how you can try to describe them beyond the mean field approach. Okay, so let's start maybe with the basics. So how to describe in the simplest way the fermionic quasi-particle. And let's start by writing the Hamiltonian of the system. It's a good start, I think. So this Hamiltonian contains two terms. So the Hamiltonian of the free fermions with the kinetic energy minus the chemical potential in the grand canonical ensemble. And then it contains an interaction term, contact interaction term, so when the fermions are on the same location, which is controlled by this coupling constant G naught, which we eliminate in the end, or I should say rather, we normalize in favor of this scattering length. So this Hamiltonian is quartic. You cannot diagonalize it exactly, so you have to rely on approximations. The most obvious approximation that you can do is a Milfield approximation, whereby you replace this quartic term by a quadratic one through the introduction of a self-consistent pairing field delta, which is G times the average value of psi psi. And then you solve self-consistently for delta by minimizing the energy. So if you do that, what you get is this kind of VCS Hamiltonian, which describes so the ground state energy. And above that, two branches of fermionic excitation, spin up and spin down, which have in fact the same eigenenergy, given by this BCS formula. You see square root of delta squared plus the energy of free fermion squared. So the energy of those fermionic quasiparticles, you see, it depends quite crucially on the ratio between mu and delta. So when and mu and delta, they can be...
Adrian, may I have a question?
Yes, sure.
Actually, considering this mean field theory, I have field operators which are replaced by a number. It means that this theory is such theory that the number of particles is not conserved, yes?
Yes.
And then is there some version of that which will conserve the number of atoms?
Yes, you can.
We know that there
is theory in a way which is number conserving. Yes,
but it exists for bosons, but I'm not sure about fermions.
Yes, it also exists for fermions, but in the thermodynamic limit, both approach will lead to the same result. Right, the correction, or the errors that comes from not conserving the number of particles tend to zero with the number of particles.
Mm-hmm. Raise the hand.
Yes. Hello.
Ski, please.
I'm not sure who is running what, and I don't know whether I'm recognized. Am I recognized by someone or?
Yeah, I can hear you perfectly well.
Or can I ask a question or
yes,
not?
You can ask, yes, true.
Of course.
All right. The question is that this Hamiltonian, which is written down on the view graph, and the assumption which is made, it's exactly what is done in the BCS model.
But yes,
the problem of the conservation of the fermions is then taken into account by the fact that this Hamiltonian is not applicable to all fermions in the system, but only to the very narrow number of fermions close to the Fermi surface. So there is an assumption that there is almost a continuum number of particles which are sitting inside of the Fermi sphere, which works as a kind of a reservoir. So the fact that this Hamiltonian does not conserve number of fermions is irrelevant for the analysis. And I don't know, is this Hamiltonian which you had written applicable to the complete total number of fermions in your system? Because then is a question from where this interaction comes, that the particles pair, the Cooper pairs are formed on the bottom of the Fermi surface or at the top of it and above it.
I was just about to explain. Maybe you let me continue and then, this problem of non-conserving the number of fermions, like I said, it's a problem that has been discussed a lot, and people have agreed that with this mean field, with the symmetry breaking mean field approximation, you only introduce errors that tend to zero at the thermodynamic limit. So
but that's not true, because it's a question. It's a question. What kind of interaction forms the Cooper pair independently of whether the energy of the constituent fermions is close to the Fermi surface or not? That's the whole problem of a superconductivity. There is only a very narrow region of the energies in the system which permits the interaction between fermions to pair them. And that happens in enormous superconductors.
In a superconductor, but not in a strongly interacting Fermi gas. In a strongly interacting Fermi gas.
Hamiltonian
refers to all the fermions are paired.
Even those at the bottom of the
Fermi. Maybe let me explain the dispersion of this branch, and you will see that in ultra cold gases, you can reach a regime where all the fermions are in fact tightly bound dimers. So they are all
guys, could I inject this short remark, a very short one? There is a huge difference between super conductivity and this ultra cold gas, because in our case, there is no long range Coulomb interaction. It is this long range Coulomb interaction that requires all these screening effects that lead to what Łukasz is telling us. We are talking about something completely different. The only interaction is this short-range piece.
So in other words, the answer should be that the pairing here happens for all fermions independently of...
That's correct.
That was my question, and that's a very simple answer. Thank you very much.
In fact, look at this figure. So when delta is very small, which for ultra cool gases is a
That is at the bottom of the picture. I mean, all right.
So when the inverse scattering length tends to minus infinity, this dispersion relation, in fact, is sensitive to delta only in a very narrow region around the Fermi level, where a small gap opens in the free fermion dispersion relation, this red curve. So that's in the so-called BCS limit where the superconductors are. And so indeed their pairing occurs only here around the minimum of this branch. But by tuning the interaction strengths, you can reach the regime where delta is very large, or if you prefer, the inverse scattering length tends to plus infinity. And then what you obtain are very tightly bound, almost bosonic dimers, on the contrary, I mean, unlike in the BCS regime where you have weakly correlated Cooper pairs. And so in this case, the system behaves like a Bose-Einstein condensate of composite bosons. In fact, the gap here is very large. So all the fermions are strongly paired. And by tuning the interaction strength, in fact, you can go continuously, as you can see here, from this red curve to the orange one. So, and the gap continuously increases by going from this BCS to this Bose-Einstein condensate regime. You can see also that the location of the minimum here shifts to zero until it eventually reaches zero at some point because the chemical potential becomes negative. Well, so that this is called the BC-BCS crossover. This is something you can study with ultra cold gases by tuning the scattering length. So those sorry, I should come back. Those BCS excitation physically they correspond to a situation where you rip out one fermion from the gas, so you take out the blue fermions and then you're left with an unpaired red fermion excited in the gas. Is something that can happen experimentally if an operator is acting on the system, for example, by RF spectroscopy, trying to take out one fermion. But this is obviously not something that can happen spontaneously in the gas, because it's changing the number of fermions and also the polarization. What can happen spontaneously on the other end are those bi-excitation, whereby a pair of fermions breaks up into two unpaired fermions. This can happen, for example, as an effect of thermal or quantum fluctuation. And so this pi excitation, it has 2 degrees of freedom, the wave vectors of the two excited fermions. So if I fix, let's say, the center of mass momentum of those excited fermions, Q here, and then I vary vertically the internal wave vector, what I get is a continuum of excitation, which is bounded from below by twice the 2 delta, twice the gap, and however is unbounded from above. So that's the origin of the this continuum of excitation in Fermi gases. So now we want to study collective mode, and I will start at low energy by what happens below this continuum here, which is conceptually maybe a bit simpler. And that, so to study what happens here at low energy, in fact, you don't need a complicated microscopic theory. You can just describe the physics there by quantum hydrodynamics. So it's a theory which kind of forgets about the fermionic quasi-particles, the fermions, the atoms, and describes the gas mesoscopically by two bosonic fields, the density and the velocity potential density rho, the velocity potential phi, which are canonically conjugated bosonic fields. And so those, the evolution of those fields is governed by this hydrodynamic Hamiltonian, which is kind of standard. You see it contains the kinetic energy, rho v squared, and then some interaction part, which depends only on the density, with this function E naught, which is the ground state energy per particle. So if you prefer, the derivative of this E naught is the chemical potential. This simple hydrodynamic Hamiltonian already admits some eigenmodes that I can obtain by expanding at for small fluctuation of the density and the velocity around the homogeneous solution. And then I linearizing this Hamiltonian, what I get is a branch of excitation with a linear spectrum proportional to Q with a proportionality factor, the speed of sound, which is related.
Problem with this Hamiltonian.
Sorry?
I have a technical question. This hydrodynamic Hamiltonian, as you call it, why did you write it in that form? That's not the generic form which comes out from the, if you use the decomposition of a field operators in terms of rho and phi. I mean, the position of the density operator in between the velocity operators is an arbitrary choice because they do not each other. So why did you choose that one? This is not, there will be another terms possible. Actually, this Hamiltonian, normal Schrödinger quantum mechanics leads to the wrong results because it does not fit to this term which is crucial for quantum mechanics, which is called the quantum pressure term, which is proportion to the gradient of the square root of the density operator. And yeah, that's
this is beyond hydrodynamics. This quantum pressure is not there in hydrodynamics.
No, well, then you have made an assumption that you throw it out. Why?
No, but you should understand that I'm not starting from some microscopic theory and then try to recover hydrodynamics. I'm just describing the gas at low energy, long wavelengths, as if I'm forgetting about the underlying microscopy physics to begin with.
Quantum pressure term is responsible for Heisenberg uncertainty relation, and that is applicable to the low energy and high energy. So there must be a reason why you this Hamiltonian is neither classical nor quantum. That was just the no further question.
So quantum pressure will matter only at larger values of Q. If we want, we can discuss it in more detail, but it will only lead to correction. For example, if you look at the dispersion relation, quantum pressure will only correct it by some terms of order Q3. So when you're at the Q tending to zero limit, then...
That depends on the dimensionality of the system. The quantum pressure term is, for example, responsible for the vortices.
Yeah, okay. Here I'm 3D all along this talk. Maybe I should have said that more clearly. I'm sorry. Everything is 3D here. Huh? But, well, Voilà, so, and I think this is the correct writing of the Hamiltonian. I took that from the Landau-Kalatnikov quantum hydrodynamics. So, cool. Yeah, so you get this linear spectrum with a speed of sound. And in fact, this brand, so at low Q here, what you are describing are phonons, sound waves, which you can quite easily excite experimentally by doing Bragg spectroscopy. What you do is you shine a laser field, which is specially modulated at some given momentum Q, and then you tune the energy of the exciting Bragg field. And what you see when you vary the energy is this resonance here around the eigenfrequency of the collective mode. This is taken from an experiment done in Australia. Of course, there is some experimental broadening here, but the dispersion matches here the linear dispersion predicted by hydrodynamics. Voilà, so we're not only interested in what happens at low Q, one can try to see what happens at a bit higher Q. And you see clearly here that you will run into a problem when this gap is very small, because the linear start will be troubled by the ceiling of the continuum. So to describe that, you cannot rely on hydrodynamic anymore, like we have discussed. You need some other theory. So either you have some quantum pressure, or you can just use a fully ab initio theory, like a microscopic one. Some, for example, time-dependent BCS theory. And what you find in this case is that the branch has to bend down to avoid entering the continuum. So we say that it is subsonic because its velocity is below the speed of sound here. So that's in the BCS limit. In the BEC regime, however, the gap here is very, very high, such that your phonon branch almost doesn't feel it. And in this case, in fact, it bends up as it would do, as the Bogoliubov branch would do in a Bose-Einstein condensate. So in this case, in the BEC regime, the branch is supersonic. And this is something quite original, that by tuning their interaction, you can tune the phonon branch to be supersonic or subsonic. It has interesting consequences for the dynamics of the gas. First example, how can you see the evolution triggered by this branch of phonons? This is an experiment from an American group. You see what they do is they shine a laser field at the center of the gas. So they excite some density bump here. Then they let it evolve. And you see that two counterpropagating wave packet forms that travel at the speed of sound. And here the size of the trap was a bit too small. But if you wait a bit longer, in fact, you would be sensitive to the dispersion of the branch. What forms, in fact, those wave packets, they turn into those dispersive shock waves. So they acquire a sharp solitonic edge here, which is due to nonlinear effect. And then you see either in front of this edge or behind, depending on the sign of this dispersion, this gamma parameter of Q3, you observe an oscillatory train, which tells you if the dispersion is subsonic or supersonic. So this would be a way if you want to be sensitive to the sign of this dispersion.
Excuse me, Adrian, what's actually on y-axis? I didn't get, because on x-axis I have just the relative position, yes? Of this. So,
yes, it's the position. At some fixed time, it's just the position. I study only one wave packet, right? So yeah, there is, yeah, of course, a symmetric one. And here is just the density fluctuation.
Uh-huh, so it's like...
phi is like the amplitude of the density fluctuation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
This is what you would see if you would take a absorption image of the density.
And this gamma is...
And gamma then is a dimensionless parameter. So here it's not dimensionless, but you have to redefine it, but the sign of this gamma controls whether the branch is like that. When gamma is positive, the branch bends up. When gamma is negative, the branch bends down.
Mm-hmm. I ask the question, is this the three-dimensional, two-dimensional, one-dimensional system?
It's a quasi 1D system, yes.
Yeah,
you can also shock waves in 3D system. It's just
the question is, this dispersion relation is a curious dispersion relation in more than one dimension, because a Q is a wave vector. So the question is, what is meant by the Q to the power 3? In three dimensions or two dimensions, and even the Q is a wave vector, so it's a vector. So it's not clear what is the meaning of the Q to the power 3. So, is it because, I mean, is it the length of the vector to the power 3?
Yes, it's the length, yes, of course.
That is not necessarily true for the dispersion relation, because
the wave vector. Yeah, no, the wave number, sorry. It's the...
Is a derivative of... Well, all right, anyway.
Sorry, I did not get your question.
We shouldn't interrupt each other, because Zoom is working in such a way that if one person is talking and then the second person will start to add something, even small digression, then there is problem with Zoom, who is the main speaker. So we have to try to avoid any interruption during questions and answers. So thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so... Then another way to be sensitive to this to those phonons is to look at the dissipative dynamics in the gas. So any coefficient that describes the relaxation of the system back to equilibrium, for example, viscosity or thermal conductivity, those kind of coefficients, to describe them, you need phonons, of course, but you also need to describe the residual interactions among phonons. Because, in fact, at low temperature, all you have in the gas are a few phonons. And those residual interactions among phonons, they will allow the system, the energy to flow between the modes, and so the system to relax back to equilibrium. And so a good way to be sensitive to those interactions among phonons is to compute the lifetime, or the damping rate, of those phonons, which give an imaginary part to their energy here. And so to compute that, what you do is that you go back to your hydrodynamic Hamiltonian and you keep expanding it in powers of the density fluctuation. So the quadratic part here describes the three phonons, and then H3 describes three-body residual interaction, H4 four-body, and so on. So at low temperature, you have only a few phonons. So naively, what you would say is the probability of having four phonons is much suppressed compared to the probability of having three phonons close to each other. So what will dominate the dissipation are those three phonon processes called lambda Belyaev process. So the Belyaev process is when your phonon decays into two. Lambda is when he absorbs another phonon. They are described by those B dagger B term in the H3 Hamiltonian. But if you compute the lifetime, which is due to those processes, you find that it's non-zero at zero temperature, because your phonon can always decay. In fact, it varies like Q5 at equals zero. And then at finite temperature, what you find is that for thermal phonons, the lifetime should scale like temperature to the power 5. But in fact, what happens when your branch is subsonic, so concave, when it bends down, is that those lambda Belyaev processes are energetically forbidden. In fact, you can see that as a consequence of the Landau criterion for the critical velocity. So when the branch is subsonic, in fact, the incoming phonons, it has a velocity slightly below the speed of sound. And so like an impurity, it cannot emit in the gas another phonon. And so those processes will be forbidden. And in this case, so when this branch is bent down, what will dominate the lifetime as are those four body scattering processes among phonons, which are described by those B-dagger, B-dagger, BB terms in H4. And so in this case, the lifetime should be zero at zero temperature, because you see you need some incoming phonon to scatter on the phonon that you've excited. And at non-zero temperature, it can be non-zero, sorry. And in fact, you can show that it will vary as temperature to the power 7 for thermal phonons. So this is something we found quite interesting, that you can go from those two, you can change of the main dissipation mechanism by just tuning the interaction strength, which changes the bending of the dispersion relation. And I should say that there are some measurements ongoing of this damping rate now in the group of Martin Sierlein at MIT. So there at unitarity, which is when the scattering length is infinite, the interactions are the strongest. And there actually it's not known really if the branch is subsonic or supersonic. So it's not known which of those two cases they will be. I mean, we can predict that from the time-dependent BCS theory, but of course, it's not perfectly quantitative. So it would be nice to have some experimental results. All right, so I'm done with the density excitation. Now let me raise a bit the excitation frequency until I pass the threshold of the continuum. I'm above 2 delta. And I'm probing the response at high energy. And so since this is more easily done experimentally than theoretically, let's first discuss a bit what the experiments see. So the experiments so far are only at Q equals zero. So they do homogeneous excitation of the gas. And so what they see, you see on those experimental graphs, is this fairly asymmetric peak, which is right at the edge of the continuum, so at 2 delta. It has a very sharp lower edge and then a broad tail at high energy. This is a picture taken from a cold atom experiment. And this is a picture here taken from an experiment on superconductors, because, well, what I will say here is very analogous. What I will say here about cold gases is very analogous to what happens in superconductors. In fact, here, like you say, Kajik, the main difference between ultra cold gases and superconductors are Coulomb interaction. But for these high energy mode, in fact, Coulomb interaction do not matter so much. So you can draw this nice analogy with superconductors. So the question that everyone is asking is, what is this peak? Why do I see a peak here at 2 delta? Is it because I have a collective mode? Or is it simply because, you know, it's the edge of the continuum? So at the edge of the continuum, you expect some singularity somehow. Well, so there's this question, which was ongoing in the literature. A way to get an indice on the answer is to look, which has also been done experimentally, at the time response, which corresponds to this frequency response here. So it's like you Fourier transform this peak. And what you get are, you see here, oscillations of the order. So what you do, you excite your system at t equals zero. And then you monitor its evolution after some interrogation time. And what you see is that the system oscillates at a frequency which matches very well to delta. You see it here. But those oscillations are damped in time, which you could expect for a collective mode which is coupled to a continuum. But they are not damped exponentially, surprisingly. They are damped as a power law, which with an exponent which is shown here. So for a collective mode,
well, this is of course known from the studies of near threshold ionization, that if you get such an edge, then there are non-exponential effects.
Yes. Yeah, I'll come back to it, but there is still a debate because some people are still speaking of this edge as a collective mode. So we want to clarify and say if it is or not a collective mode. In our opinion, it's still not clear, and it was still not clear in the literature. So that's for Q equals zero. Then at a non-zero wave number, there are no experiments yet, but there are some theoretical prediction, and they're also quite disagreeing. There is like an American prediction, let's say, about Littlewood and Varma, which I should say was the most widespread in the literature. And so what they predict is a collective mode whose energy will depart from 2 delta with an imaginary part linearly, which varies linearly with Q, you see here, and then a real part which varies quadratically with Q. On the other end, there is a prediction in the Russian literature, which this time is quadratic for both the real and imaginary part. And you can see that even the coefficient of the real part is in disagreement between those two predictions. Bon, so the suspense won't be long, but you can choose your side between those two predictions. let me now sketch a bit the theory of how you describe those collective modes at high energy. So for that, you can no longer use hydrodynamics or some simple theory. You need some microscopic description. So what you do is that you let the system fluctuate around the mean field state that we've described. So both the pairing field delta will fluctuate, and also the density. And then to describe the experimental driving, you introduce some drive forces described by this Hamiltonian. So there is one field which excites the density U, and then one field phi. So this U can describe, for example, the laser field, which acts on the density. And then there is another field phi, which is coupled to the pairing field, and which can describe, for example, modulation of the interaction strength, which excites the pairing field. So then what you should do is compute the response of the system to those excitations. So for that, you will write equation of motion for the fluctuation of delta and rho. You will linearize them because we are looking at linear response here. So for that, we use a random phase approximation where you replace those any quartic operator by this partially contracted Vic form, you see. So if you do that, you find that the response of the system in the density and the phase and amplitude of the order parameter is just linearly related to the exciting field through some 3x3 matrix called the response matrix, chi, which is expressed in terms of the pair propagator M here. And so a collective mode is when the response of the system diverges for some finite exciting field. So that's when this response function has a pole, or if you prefer, when the determinant of 1/chi has a root. So far you may say, well, it's a very well-known situation. We have that also in high energy physics. You know what we will get? We'll get a Goldstone mode for the phase response, and then a Higgs mode for the delta, for the modulus response. But in fact, this is not it's a kind of misleading way to think, we believe, because here, this response function, it contains the pair propagator, and so it is sensitive to the underlying fermionic structure of the pairs. You see here, I gave the expression of one of those matrix elements of the pair propagator. You see that it has in the denominator this fermionic continuum, which I drew in red earlier. And so below 2 delta, everything goes fine. This is a smooth function. And in fact, you can find a pole here on the real axis, which describes the phononic branch we've already discussed. But above 2 delta, this function is not regular at all anymore. It's not a polynomial. It has a singularity in 2 delta. And above 2 delta, it has a branch cut, the discontinuity of the imaginary part, such that the situation is in fact very different. So making comparison with Higgs modes, where in fact this M function would be a polynomial, something very smooth, seems very misleading to us. So we avoid this comparison. But the fact that there is a branch cut here due to the Fermionic continuum does not mean, on the other hand, that you cannot have a collective mode, that it is necessarily overdamped or whatever. That, like the opinion also exists. If you want to study collective mode, what you should do simply is rotate this branch cut by doing an analytic continuation to see if you can find a pole in the lower half complex plane whose imaginary part will describe the lifetime of the mode that you obtain, or if you prefer, of the imaginary part will describe the width of the response function. So this is this looks simple when you say it like that, but in fact, in practice, it's not easy to do this analytic continuation. So we developed some analytical and numerical techniques. Maybe I will skip on that because I've been already quite long. But basically, what you have to do is compute the spectral density, which records the discontinuity of the response function when crossing the branch cut. So I skip on that and just go to the result. So what we find is that there exists indeed a pole in this analytic continuation as long as mu is positive. So when you're on the BCS side, not just the BCS limit, but mu has to be positive. And we find indeed, so we agree with the Russian prediction, we find a quadratic depart of the eigenenergy, which is controlled by some parameter zeta here in front of Q squared. And so this zeta tends in the weak coupling BCS limit, which is here on this graph, to the value which was predicted by Popov and Andreyanov. I've already shown you the formula. And then you see, as you go away from the BCS limit, the real part of zeta decreases, which means that the excitation branch becomes flatter and flatter at low Q, until eventually, which was a bit surprising, this zeta becomes negative for some above some value of mu. In other words, it means that the real part of this eigenenergy is below 2 delta. So at first, we are a bit puzzled by that. What does that mean? Does that mean that mode inside the band gap or so on? Well, in fact, you have to remember that we are doing an analytic continuation, but what matters in the end is what happens on the real axis, because that's where the response functions are measured. The experimentalists, they don't go to the analytic continuation. And so when you have a mode whose frequency is below 2 delta, in fact, it does not affect what happens between at low energy here, because there is still this branch cut that we have rotated here. And so when the mode is, when the eigenenergy is below 2 delta, all you can see is maybe an upper tail of the resonance here in the region of the real axis where this analytic continuation is meaningful. And so in fact, here in the strongly coupled regime, what our results show is that probably the resonance will be less observable, harder to see. Well, so then we can go a bit at larger Q with our numerical techniques. So you see that after the quadratic depart of the branch, maybe so first the imaginary part of the collective mode, it starts quadratically and it remains a monotonically increasing function of Q, which means basically that as you increase Q, the resonance will broaden and broaden, the damping will grow larger, until you can not even see anything because it's too broad. And the real part, conversely, it goes through a maximum and then it drops below 2 delta again at large Q. That's in the BCS regime. So at large Q also, the observability will be lower. So that's the conclusion. So to finally convince you that this collective mode is really observable, what I should do maybe finally is show you what is seen on the response function, so on the real axis, and show you that this can be fitted to extract the eigenenergy that we've computed. So here I show you a color plot of the amplitude response function. So this corresponds experimentally to a situation where you excite the pairing field. You can do that with cold atom by exciting the scattering length, and then you measure it after some time, some excitation time. And so here is Q on the x-axis and the energy on the y-axis. You can see clearly below the continuum this phononic branch, which is infinitely narrow here. And above to delta, you can see obviously some resonance. You can see some quadratic depart quite clearly. And then you can even see that there is some maximum here around here, maybe. So if I do a cut of this color figure around here, what I see is this very nice resonance, very smooth resonance here, with a peak which is slightly displaced from 2 delta. And I can fit this peak by a function which describes a resonance with some residue here in the numerator, plus a flat background describing the incoherent contribution of the continuum. And if I fit this peak, in fact, I can extract very well the eigenenergy, the real part, the imaginary part of the collective mode, and also its residue. So this is quite satisfactory. This was in the BCS regime. However, if I go to the BEC regime, like I told you, in fact, this branch becomes unobservable because only its upper tail is visible. And so that's this figure where you see you do not have a resonance varying quadratically with Q. You only have a sharp edge which is pinned at the lower edge of the continuum. And this is no longer a collective mode. This corresponds here on this cut figure to this sharp blue peak here. So this is just a singularity at the edge of the continuum. It's not something you can call a collective response. Voilà, so that was for the...
Sorry for interrupting you, but we have only 5 minutes, so we should go to...
I'm almost finished. That was for the modulus response. So this is something you can probe with cold atom, but this was not done yet. What was done already is probing the density response. So I've shown you already, I've explained you already those Bragg spectroscopy. So when you do that, in fact, in the continuum, you find a very shallow peak. That's because, in fact, the density is only weakly coupled to the fluctuation of the modulus of delta. In fact, in the weak coupling limit, they are completely decoupled. At strong coupling, they're a bit coupled, but not that much. But you see that qualitatively, in fact, there is some agreement concerning the shape of this peak above 2 delta in the density response. Of course, this is a bit preliminary. One should, in particular, see if this peak that they see experimentally varies quadratically with Q, as we predict. Okay, so there was this discussion about what happens. So all what I've said was at Q non-zero so far. At Q equals zero, what happens? There was this discussion. So when you look at my dispersion, you may say, well, there is clearly a mode here with energy 2 delta and zero imaginary part. But what you should remember, in fact, is that this pole that we have found also has a residue. And what we see is that this residue cancels linearly with Q, such that in the end, you get a non-analytic singularity, a square root singularity in the response function. And so for us, this is not a collective mode. So exactly at Q equals zero, you should not speak of a collective mode, let alone a Higgs mode. You just have a square root singularity at the edge of the continuum, which is something interesting to study, but not a collective mode. And if you then look in the time domain, like I've said already, what you see are those power law damped oscillation of the order parameter. Voilà, so maybe I'm out of time, so I'll skip this part where I wanted to close the loop and explain to you how the fermionic quasar particles are affected in return by the activity. So with that, I thank you for your attention and for your questions.
Okay, thank you. People are confused more, that's why we couldn't hear them. There were some questions during this talk, but we have still time for more questions.
May I?
Yes, please.
Okay, so this excitation very close to the edge, as I already mentioned, reminds me of the ionization near threshold. Now, when you look at these atomic systems, then there is a huge difference between near threshold ionization of neutral atom and of negative ion. Neutral atom is characterized by the Rydberg series that goes all the way to the edge, while with the negative ions, we've got a gap below the threshold. Now, could you tell me, perhaps I should have understood, but I did not, whether the system that you are studying is closer to this neutral atom or to the negative ion? I guess there are excitations just immediately below the threshold in your case. Am I right?
You mean here?
Yeah.
No, here there are no excitations because you see here it's the continuum of two fermionic excitations.
Yes.
And to have one fermionic excitation, already you need an energy delta. So to have two, you need two delta. If you are below two delta, you cannot excite anything.
Good. So it seems to me that you are much closer to this negative ion situation. And
yes,
there,
perhaps.
Decades ago, we've discussed, with Maciej Levenstein, we've discussed two things. One is this peculiar departure from the exponential decay. But later on, actually in 1998, I believe, we've also pointed out that this gives rise to the quantum anti-Zeno effect. In other words, if the system is interrogated very often, it decays faster. I wonder whether this phenomenon can be observed also here.
Yes, this is an interesting suggestion. Yeah, if you probe repeatedly the system, this is something that has not been tried, yes. But
unlike what is deeply in literature, namely that this probing slows down the decay, which is true, of course, for the system that, you know, have some other analytic properties, in your case, it should speed up.
It should speed up, okay. But only when you have a non-Lorentzian resonance, right?
Oh, absolutely. That's the spectral side of the same thing.
Okay. Because you see, at non-zero Q, you're in the usual case where you have this Lorentzian resonance. It's something perfectly standard. It's only when you have zero that the edge is right. That the peak is right at the edge. Okay, yes, it's a good suggestion, yes.
Yeah.
Maybe you can send me this reference, or I can try to find it myself.
But. Well, you can find it very easily.
Okay, thank you.
The other group that looked at similar problems in great detail is that of Gershon Kuritsky from Israel, about the same time.
Okay.
But you better quote us.
Okay. Of course.
We are in overtime, actually. Are there any other questions? I think we should then stop. If you have more questions, you can contact with Adrian or with me. And with that, I would like to thank to Adrian again, and you can finish this colloquium. I don't know, maybe Adam is here. What is the next speaker in 1 week, or Maciek?
So actually, sorry, we will have a talk tomorrow at 12, which is the continuation of the talk which we had last week on Wednesday by Anya David. And next week on Wednesday, I think we will have quantum information talk.
by Eric Aurel, as far as I remember.
Okay, so thank you and see you maybe tomorrow and in 1 week. I'm finishing recording.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.